Now, the film festival is into its 22nd year, but arguably it is also on a decline. There was a time when movie lovers can only find arthouse films at the festival itself. But in the past decade, movie distributors, museums and embassies have started bringing these arthouse titles into their cinemas and screening rooms, making the films at the film festival less exclusive. Websites like Amazon.com have also made these DVD versions more easily available. And sadly, so has rampant piracy. How does the film festival plan to stay alive? We spoke to Zhang Wenjie.
So this is a much smaller festival than it was in its heyday. Maybe 6 to 7 years ago, SIFF was playing at Shaw or GV cinemas, but now the venues seem to have shrunk. You're now showing, the bulk of the films are showing at the Substation, National Museum, as well as the Arts House screening room. Is the festival struggling?
Okay, we actually still have Shaw. It's actually one of our main venues as well.
Yeah, but you have a limited number of
titles. Yeah, we have less titles at Shaw. So in terms of the number of films we have this year, it's slightly smaller. What we've been trying to look at the festival as a program is that sometimes, I think there's some years where we have like maybe 400 films, you know, 300 plus films, 400 films. And we find that the size of it sometimes is a bit overwhelming for our audience. Like 300 films, I mean, how many films are you going to realistically watch there? And so this year, actually, we're looking at doing a smaller program, but tighter program. You don't need to have a big festival to be a success, to be a successful film festival. I know, like in this age and time, like everyone is there has no time for anything. You know, just everything's like for films wise, you can watch something on YouTube. There's something on the internet. You can download films. And I think a lot of us who are in this film festival business, we share this common thing is that we feel that a film festival itself, it still offers a very unique film-going experience that perhaps, you know, all the other things that I spoke about just now might not have. Like, for example, if you buy a film from Amazon.com, you watch it at home, maybe with a few friends. But like, if you imagine a film festival where it's over, let's say, 2 weeks, you have guest filmmakers coming from all over the world, you know, coming to present their films. A lot of these films are premieres, either at their home country or perhaps some are international premieres, world premieres. First time you'll ever be seeing the film. The filmmaker is there to present the film. You know, you're sitting in a packed hall, you know, with people. Whether you like the film or not, you know, you'll discuss it later. And you know, the interaction with people and the going and to and fro, you know, you meet up with people, you talk about film. And this, everyone is caught up in this buzz of the film festival. And I think for a lot of people, still, it's a very nice way to experience a film.
But do you think that this buzz that you're talking about, do you think that you're still preaching to the converted? Are you actually generating new audiences?
Actually, this year, something that we try to do very consciously is we have a new look for the festival in terms of how the program is being put together in the program book, the website, and even in terms of the sections. So like, I mean, just now I mentioned about actually putting the films into slightly smaller sections, but more, hopefully more well-organized sections. So it's easier for people to find a way around. Like because I think for a lot of people, the program is sort of like a passport to the films, you know, to the film festival. So we hope to make that thing as accessible as possible. New audiences are actually very important to us. I mean, yes, I think there's a bunch of very loyal fans from years ago, but we are really, really interested to welcome new people, you know, to the SIFF. I think sometimes we underestimate the audience, as in we always think, oh, let's put some big name titles and, you know, maybe the festival will be more popular. But I feel that actually there's the audience actually is very very knowledgeable, and we don't have to bend over backwards to kind of get them to come to the festival.
Mm. Well, the internet, YouTube, video games, all these have a significant impact on the way people view films and on the way that films are being made. Do you see any developments or any influence of those things on indie filmmaking in Asia?
I think it's just, okay, I think information is faster and there's more out there. So, I guess in terms of, I think not just films, but let's say for example if there's a really great new film, you know, made by this filmmaker, almost instantly you if it's shown at this festival, you will see blogs coming out and all that. So I would say in terms of the dissemination of information is really fast, since like, you know, when the cost of making a film is cheaper in terms of like maybe the advancement of technology, you know, people can use a camera and DV camera to shoot as compared to a film camera. I think definitely more films are being made, but with more films being made, doesn't mean that all these films are great, you know, there's a lot of very bad films out there also. I think we have quite a strong competition section this year. Like in the competition section, there's this amazing Malaysian indie film called Sell Out, which I think is unlike any Malaysian indie film you've ever seen. It's funny, it's a satire, and it's a musical. You know, it's called Sell Out. It's in competition, and the filmmaker, his name is Yunan. He studied in Singapore in RJC, and he uses. I think part of the film is based on the experience of his education here. That's a very interesting film to see. Our opening film is called Sincerely Yours. It's a Taiwanese film. It's an international premiere, so the filmmaker and the cast is coming out. It's a first time feature film by a new Taiwanese filmmaker. And we find that very exciting as well.
One of the things that you added to this year's festival is the Singapore Film Awards, where you honour the best in Singapore filmmaking. But there have been criticism from various people saying that these films, not all these films are good. In fact, some rather weak films have managed to get into competition. What do you have to say about that?
I think our main objective of actually putting together the Singapore Film Awards this year is that I think our main objective is really to celebrate Singapore film, you know, feature films that are, whether it's a commercial feature film or something that's a little bit more indie and then it has a maybe a short run, let's say at the Arts House and all that. So we wanted actually to celebrate the diversity of Singapore film. So that's the reason we started this award. We wanted to be inclusive in terms of like, it's not just a commercial film that we want to put in an award or we want to put into the nomination or indie film. So we have a whole bunch of Singapore films that's made in the previous year.
Sure, but yeah. I'm talking about quality of films. Some of these films aren't exactly good, objectively speaking. Why are they in competition?
Actually, when the films are nominated, all the nominated films in the Singapore Film Award, we all feel that there's something in the film that deserves it to be nominated. So the films might not be great or at this point of time, but we're not so much like, for the Singapore Film Awards, we're not so much like we wanted to be inclusive in terms of the nomination. So like the films that we put in the nomination, we all really believe that there's something in the film that deserves to be nominated.
Alright, thank you so much for being part of Razor Pop.
Yo, what up?
It's Razor Pop La!